our regular meeting tonight. We have a public hearing this evening, so I'd like to call tonight's public hearing to order. Okay, so a public hearing is organized according to Section 890 of the Local Government Act. Tonight's public hearing involves the Interim Zoning Amendment Bylaw Number 3408-2016. The intent of the bylaw is to amend the City of Prince Rupert Zoning Bylaw Number 3286-2009 to temporarily establish commercial marijuana operations as prohibited use in all zones. So I'll read out some of the process around public hearings, and then we'll get into speakers. So every person present who believes that their interest is affected by the proposed bylaw shall be given a reasonable opportunity to be heard respecting matters contained in the proposed bylaw. None of you will be discouraged or prevented from making your views known. However, it is important to restrict your remarks to matters contained in the proposed bylaw. A person may make their statement in writing as outlined in the public notice, and if received by the deadline, their presentation will be read by staff at the public hearing. If a person wishes to make a presentation at the public hearing, they are welcome to do so, provided that the following criteria are followed. This is necessary in order to allow for the recording of the public hearing process. Chairperson will recognize only those individuals who present themselves at the table and speak into the microphone. Prior to speaking, please provide your full name and be prepared to spell your surname for the corporate administrator. Please also provide your residential or business address. Should you wish to read from a prepared statement, the city would appreciate receiving a copy for reference purposes by the corporate administrator. Members of council may, if they so wish, ask questions of you following your presentation. Please note that this is not a question period at which a debate takes place. City Council will not provide any comments on issues raised, but will be in attendance to listen to all concerns presented. So before we go into the public hearing, I want to just say a few words about what's on the table here, just so that there's clarification around what this proposed bylaw is all about. And so what this is a proposal to temporarily ban all commercial marijuana operations in all zones in the City of Prince Rupert for a one-year period. So this period ends January 1st, 2018, so it sunsets then. And the intention is that the federal government is going to regulate recreational use of marijuana this year. It's anticipated that sometime this spring there will be some sort of legislation where the federal government will come out with a legalization framework around that. And so what we're decided to do, or what we're intending to do, is to essentially say, let's wait until we know what the federal government's going to do. And then once we know what the federal legal framework's going to look like, we would base our municipal rules based on what the federal government rules will be. And so that being said, folks need to understand that what we are proposing here today does not apply to medical marijuana. So if you have a license to use or to grow, you are still permitted to do those. So that does not affect that. There was a clinic coming to town that potentially wants to set up. That clinic falls within the use. That's all fine. People also need to understand that at this moment in time, dispensaries are still illegal in Canada, which is not a municipal issue, is a federal issue. And so that is just the law at this time, but we know that law is potentially changing this year. Also, this public hearing is not about a debate around or a dispute around whether there's health benefits or not health benefits to using marijuana. That is a federal health matter. We're simply saying to temporarily ban commercial operations until such time as the federal legalization framework comes out. And once that comes out, we will make municipal framework around that. And we anticipate that that will be completed by the sunset clause, which is January 1st, 2018. So ultimately, this is all about being able to give the city some time to research what other communities are doing, to research what other licensing options there are, what are the options available to us, so that we can do this right once the first time. And so this gives us a bit of time if that's the way council chooses to move forward after tonight's public hearing. So at that being said, I just wanted to give some context, and we're absolutely here to hear some feedback from the public. So if there's a speaker that would like to come to the mic to speak their views on this matter, please come to the mic and say your name and your affiliation, and we'll get started. So I'll call the first speaker up to the mic, please. Welcome. Absolutely. And it's just the green button on the microphone there. Welcome.
Thank you. And good evening to everybody. Nice to see a lot of familiar faces here. Sorry, I have to get my glasses.
That's okay. Sorry, you just turned off the microphone, was all there. So just press it once and then it stays on for you.
Oh,
there you go.
Look at that.
Thank you.
I'm so technical.
Just for the people at home that are watching on camera.
For the record, my name is Jennifer Nelson. My address, last name Nelson, and my address is 1454 Jamaica Avenue. I was born and raised in Prince Rupert and Port Edward. Lived in Port Edward for more than 25 years, my adult years, and grew up out there until I was in grade 2, so very attached to both communities. Thank you for clarifying the bylaw that is surrounding the marijuana issue. I actually came here hoping to ask for a little bit of clarity, because when I read it, it was a little bit confusing. Sometimes I wasn't sure if you were talking about just recreational or also the medical industry. And I wanted to suggest, which is exactly what you said, that maybe this time could be used to look further into how we could build a community-enhancing environment around this medical marijuana industry. It is a very... it's a high-need industry, and in a lot of other communities that I've studied... Sorry, I'll give you a little background. I'm currently enrolled in the Northwest ACE program at our college here, and I am constructing a business plan for hopefully a tea and medical marijuana dispensary. It's just a concept. It's an idea that I have, and it would connect our community to creating a very healthy... useful environment for the medical marijuana industry users to be able to go to have support groups, information sessions, a variety of different medical marijuana products that they can have access to without having to do the hit and miss thing on the internet. But more than anything, to bring this out of the closet and bring it into light in a very acceptable and beneficial manner. So with that being said, I would like to suggest that there is some more clarity on the wording that you distinguish between the recreational industry and the medical marijuana industry in anything that you write. And I understand all the concerns with the lack of legislation, but if you could also keep in mind that that makes it difficult for anybody wanting to develop in the medical marijuana sector as well, because everybody's stuck in this gray area, and hope that council will be willing to work with the local community members that are hoping to get involved in it, maybe with the health Northern Health Association, doctors. I think it's great that the clinic is coming to town, because that should clarify a lot of the red tape things that people have to jump through to get access. But I think if you can keep in mind that easy access for the medical marijuana patients is it's almost non-existent right now, and so there is an actual need, you know, to bring forward something that is going to be functional. There are some great models for dispensaries to look at in Vancouver and Victoria. I've been working on my concept since October, and it's a very difficult industry to gain any credible data or research. You know, the facts just aren't out there, because it's kind of been an underground sort of industry for so many years. But now the medical portion has broken off since the early 2000s, or maybe even before that, and we're starting to see a few statistics flying around. But there certainly are some really good models in other communities that you can take a look at, and I hope that the council is willing to work with members of the community, RCMP, the doctors, whoever that could make this work both ways. Thank you.
Thank you for your time. Okay, anybody else who'd like to come speak can come to the microphone. Welcome.
Thank you, Council. My name is Tobias Boucher, originally Toby Lake. My time in Prince Rupert has been short. I've been here for 2 years, and I come from Toronto, where this issue has become very, very controversial in the sense that these dispensaries have popped up and they've been shut down and all sorts of things. And from the perspective of a student who's studied social work and spent time with people that have addictions to harsher drugs, I would encourage this new time with the recreation drugs coming out, there's going to be a lot of people that would choose to use this instead of a lot of those harder drugs that are much more easier to come by sometimes and yet much harder to get off. The radio station I listen to, News Talk 1010 in Toronto, talks a lot about not considerably, but I don't know where I went with that. But at the same time, the issue, I believe, is that we need to find spaces where people can freely, openly take in what they feel like taking in. No, I didn't end off very well, but thank you.
Thank you very much. Next speaker, please. Welcome.
My name is Daryl Matheson, and I was born here. I didn't grow up here, but I've been back a couple years, and I've been back and forth between different towns and seeing, you know, this same kind of controversy with everything. And I find that the more the communities that decide to go along with it instead of waiting or banning it, you know, if they take the time to find proper structure, like everybody else mentioned before, about, you know, finding safety within it. But if, you know, why wait now if it's going to help the people in our community now that need it? Not just recreational users, but people that need it for their medicinal purposes, or like the last speaker said, harsh drugs. Lot easier to take in something that everybody has been around mostly their whole life or sees everywhere, feels more comfortable with than, you know, going out and looking for their harder drugs. And it brings communities together at some point, you know, everybody starts joining in. It's really a good friend builder, people builder, all that. And yeah, I just wanted to add a little more to what everybody else said, because it's pretty much what else was on my mind. So yeah, if council would look at maybe not so much a year ban, maybe once the legal things do come out later on this summer, if we just go along with it and bring in what we can from that. But yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. Next speaker, please. Okay, I'll call a second time for the next speaker.
Is it possible to request an amendment to this amendment so that if things happen faster, that you can...
Yep, if you'd like to speak to that, you can come here, if you'd like.
I don't know how this process works, but...
If you have recommendations you would like us to make, you can definitely speak to it on the mic, and then we will consider that in the regular meeting when this is on that agenda.
Okay, thanks. Sorry, I don't know how the process works, but
no,
he brings up a very good point. We do have time because they're not planning on even addressing this until later this spring. I've surveyed a few like societies and dispensaries throughout the Lower Mainland, and they're saying that they're not expecting any legislation to go through until probably 2019. And so if you think of the timeline, there's really no reason for rushing into this 100% ban when we can take the time to better educate ourselves, work with the community, maybe build a task force or something to do the research that is necessary to understand that this is a need. Dispensaries are... They're a benefit to any community and any society because we're talking about medicine. And I think where a lot of people get really confused on this issue and where a lot of the confusion comes in is, A, the lack of clear regulations on it, for one thing, but also a lot of people don't understand that there's kind of two industries within this industry. There's the recreational sector and there's the medical sector as well. Both of these have been sort of subcultures that have been functioning very healthily, the, if you want to call it, the black market section, and, of course, the medical component of it, have been functioning since the 1960s. The recreational use is not going to go down when laws are changed. Crime will go down. These are some of the things that I've learned just in the studies that I've done. Crime goes down for regular crime and property crime, vandalism, things like that. They have statistics and they have evidence on this. So maybe just taking the time, setting a time period instead of going with a 100% ban on saying we're going to give ourselves, 6 to 8 months to look further into this and then readdress it at that time. And who knows, maybe we may have some legislation on it by then, but I don't know if it's possible to request an amendment to this amendment. Is that even a term?
Yeah, you can request an amendment.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, any other speakers? Call a second time for a speaker. And I'll call a third and final time for a speaker. Okay, seeing no one, I will entertain a motion to adjourn the public hearing. Moved by Councillor Nish, second by Councillor Ranhala. All those in favor? Okay, meeting's adjourned. I'd like to call tonight's regular meeting of council to order. Recommendation that the agenda for the regular council meeting of February 6, 2017 be adopted with the addition of agenda item 7D, correspondence from My Mountain Co-op, Shames Mountain, regarding a letter of support, and item agenda 7E, a correspondence from the Prince Rupert Rugby Club, regarding a letter of support. Moved by Councillor Ranhawa, second by Councillor Moreau. All those in favor? Motion's carried. Item 3A, recommendation of the minutes of the special council meeting of January 9th, 2016 2017 be adopted. Moved by Councillor Nish, second by Councillor Moreau. Discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed? Motion's carried. Item 3B, recommendation at the minutes of the regular council meeting of January 9th, 2017 be adopted. Moved by Councillor Nish, second by Councillor Cunningham. Discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed? Motion's carried. Okay, we have a petition and delegation tonight. Mr. Andrew Hamilton, General Manager, and Jason Gao, Manager of Community Consultation and Aboriginal Relations of Aurora LNG, regarding their project overview. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So, I'm Andrew Hamilton. This is Jason Gao. We appreciate the opportunity to come and give you, Mayor, and the remainder of Council an update on where the Aurora project is at this time. So the Aurora LNG project is a joint venture partnership between Nexen Energy and Impex Gas, British Columbia. And those are both subsidiaries of global oil and gas companies. We have oil and gas assets across Canada, but the ones that we're specifically looking at developing are in Northeast BC, and we've been working those since 2010. And our vision is to really bring that as clean burning natural gas energy source to the Asia Pacific market, primarily China and Japan, which are the home of our ownership companies. We have a long history of LNG development and operations. CNOOC, who is the parent company of Nexen, is the largest importer of LNG into China. And we have significant experience in both the design and operation of LNG facilities as well through the Asia Pacific region. So we consider ourselves to be fairly unique because we do have a shale-to-ship solution. It's all contained within British Columbia. It's a Horn River Basin, so the Fort Nelson region. We propose to produce that natural gas. We have not determined what our pipeline solution is. There's some excellent pipeline providers that we're in conversations with. Use that to bring the natural gas down to the Prince Rupert region, where it'd be liquefied, loaded onto vessels, and shipped to market. So, you know, we believe that with the environmental regulations, the safety regulations, and our experience, that, that Canada is probably one of the best locations to do a development of this nature. The resource is world-class, and there's additional world-class resources all across Western Canada. So we believe that we can develop something that would have a 25, 35, possibly even 50-year lifespan here on the coast. So, I mean, we are by far... Well, there's been many other LNG projects that will have come in to speak to you. We are not as advanced as those are. We're in the second wave. We've been taking our time. Our environmental application is in now and been accepted. We do have an open house with EAO later this week, Wednesday night at Moose Hall. And so you'll have heard the whole story about how LNG is potentially a game changer for Western Canada, the size of the industry. Specifically, the Aurora development would be about 5,000 jobs at peak during construction. Those would be based sort of on a camp within the construction site itself. More importantly, for the Prince Rupert region, over the 25 to 50-year life of the facility, we would have 200 to 400 workers employed directly by that facility. So that's just the downstream. The pipeline, the upstream, would have additional employment within their host communities as well. Our target would be to ship LNG sometime in the mid-2020s, probably in the later half of that decade, and we'd be looking at starting construction sometime in the late 2019 to 2021 range. We know from our experience in Western Canada that when you have some like these large anchor facilities in a community, that you get a lot of business development and community development around that. You provide jobs for decades for individuals. They have needs, services come in. It allows us to invest in those host communities. That allows us to work to become sort of a neighbor of choice and really have that long-term position in there. That's been our experience in North Vancouver, in Squamish, in Fort McMurray, Medicine Hat, Balzac, Okotoks, and other locations where we've had facilities that have run for decades, in some cases up to 50 years. So briefly, this is the map sort of shows that facilities, the Fort Nelson region. Pipeline corridor, again, undetermined, then down to an export facility here in the Prince Rupert region. Now, the site that we have selected through a fairly intensive site selection process is the Digby Island site. It's provincial crown land that we have an area of interest worked out with and an investigative lease with the province. We're proposing two LNG trains, about 12 million tons a year, as a starting phase. That would require two storage tanks, one berthing facility, some temporary and permanent liquefaction facilities, a material offloading facility in Casey Cove. The hope would be, of course, to expand this facility, build it out to a 24 million ton a year facility, which would be four process trains. That would require two loading berths and possibly a third storage tank at that time. So as I mentioned, we are in the process of doing the environmental assessment. We are in the public comment period, and so the open house Wednesday night is a very important part of that process to give members of the public and any stakeholders a chance to come, ask us questions, get information, talk to the regulators as well, and make sure that their opinion is heard by the regulators, as well as to make sure that if they have questions that we can answer those for them. So we would certainly encourage anyone to come out, ask questions, learn as much as they can about the facility and share their opinions. Again, so I would expect you're very familiar with this process. When the public comment period is done, the working groups and the Environmental Assessment Office continue to work that. And there are members of the City of Prince Rupert on that working group as well. So, So consultation and engagement, we know from all of our time and experience in Western Canada and actually working globally that success requires that you become a valued member of the host communities. So we understand consultation and engagement is an important part of starting your project, but it remains a critical piece of your operation throughout the life of that asset. And not just the economic life, but as you close that asset down, you decommission it, you remediate it, and you turn the land over to its next use. And so we've had many successes. You know, the Squamish chemicals plants that we shut down have been turned over to the town of Squamish and others for redevelopment. The town of Okotoks has received land from us as well when we exited the sour gas industry there. It's now a mix of natural reserve, off-leash parks, industrial and sporting facilities. And so we do understand the importance of having a long life cycle presence and then leaving a positive legacy behind once we exit those host communities. So we are available for, you know, conversations at any time. We do have a community office here. We have information available on our website. We have two team members located here in town full-time. And then we've got the project website as well where you can go to get technical details. Next steps, well, we'll work our way through the EA. In theory, that process will wrap up sometime in the third quarter of this year. I think the reality is it will take as long as it takes to get through that regulatory process. So I think Q3 is the absolute fastest it would happen. You know, as we continue to work through that environmental process, we're continuing to do ongoing site assessment, collect additional data. That may include some additional borehole drilling this year, or certainly in the years ahead, to ensure we really have good engineering details. We can do the best engineering design possible. Continue to engage with any stakeholders and communities along the way. Feedback is very important to us, and we'll do our best to incorporate it at any time in the project. And continue to engage with both the local Aboriginal groups, elected governments such as yourselves, administrations, other semi-governmental bodies like the Port Authority. And then the other key piece is where we understand that Digby Island has a lot of archaeological sites on it. We are trying to work through what the appropriate process to manage those is to get sort of the right players to the table to map out the right approach to protecting those, preserving those, and inventorying them. So to contact us, we have a 1-800 number, we have a website, an email, and we have the office here in town just a couple blocks away to make ourselves available. So that's just a very brief update as to where we're at.
Okay, great. Thank you. Questions from council? Councilor Kennedy?
Okay, a couple of questions. First of all, what plans do you have to engage Prince Rupert as a stakeholder towards our infrastructure and everything? With you bringing this into our realm, as I would say, property assessments, rental values, everything else is going to go up. There's going to be more pressure on our infrastructure and everything else. And yet, to date, I haven't heard of any engagement with us about the pressures this is going to put on our city and that from a socio-economical point of view. And one of the other things I noticed also, along with the infrastructure question, is I notice where your work camp's going to be, you've got sort of like a corridor going out to the road going to the airport. Now, I'm assuming that's to bring your workers from the airport to your work camp. Do you have any plans on upgrading the airport road as part of the plan for infrastructure?
So thank you very much for those questions. Maybe I'll answer the second one first. So the planning corridor that we have and the assumptions that we are carrying is that we would need to upgrade roads to access the airport to ensure that our use of it did not conflict with the use of the airport by sort of the existing community and future growth in the community. Those are concepts we have not had detailed discussions with the Airport Authority about at this time. Because we're still working through what the actual user load would look like, flight rotations, and things of that nature. So, and that does tie into an answer to the first question. So the conversations we have had about the socio-economic impact in the region are really tied in with the overall environmental assessment, and that those conversations have been ongoing with the working group, which includes members of the City of Prince Rupert, many of the local First Nations, other governmental and non-governmental bodies. And as we work through that, it gives us a chance to sort of test the assumptions and conclusions we've come to. And once we understand what the impacts of the development are, we would then want to begin the process of sitting down and working through municipal services agreements or other agreements of that nature to ensure that we do not impose any costs on any of the taxpayers, any of the local industry. It's very important to Aurora LNG that we carry our own freight.
Okay, also
I noticed our watershed areas in the LAA. So have you done...
Councilor Cunningham, your mic's off.
Oh, sorry. I noticed our watershed, Swatlands, Woodward, where our drinking water and that comes from, is in your LAA. Have you done any base studies on the water supply in that? I notice you've got a lot of stuff on fresh water, but I noticed there was nothing on that end of it, just on the actual Digby itself.
So if you're referring to the City of Prince Rupert's fresh water source,
yes.
So I cannot give you a specific answer as to what specific studies have been done on that. I would have to refer that back to our environmental assessment team. And so we would be happy to get back to yourself and the rest of council about specifically what tests we have done on that.
Mm-hmm. And one other question. I notice you've got, for areas in the L.A., you've got Mills Memorial Hospital listed in it also. Why would a hospital in Terrace be in the L.A.A.?
So... I think part of the reason that we go a little bit farther than just here in the Prince Rupert area is that we may have to take workers in through alternate routes if we were unable to access an airport here, or for logistics, you may have a supply yard of some type in the Terrace area because you are a little real estate constrained here in this, in Prince Rupert itself. And so by understanding the impact on the overall region, it gives us a better sense to have some honest conversations around what does a development mean, not just for Prince Rupert, but for the entire region. So that does extend up into Terrace.
I can just add to that as well. Under our Section 11 order, as dictated by the BC Environmental Assessment Office, consultation with the City of Prince Rupert and their services is a requirement under that Section 11, and so that's why they've been included as well.
Do you have any follow-up, Councillor Kenny? I'm going to come back to you after.
Yeah, go ahead.
Councillor Kenny?
Just a follow-up on that, going to Terrace with regards to the hospital and stuff and airport. Well, our airport's right there, and all the medevacs and that are back and forth. I can't see why you would be looking at that.
So again, there's no airport that has the ability to have flights land 100% of the time. If they were fogged in or there was some type of a need to circle or divert an aircraft, the next closest airport is the Terrace Airport. So that's why that would be in that planning area.
Councillor Manhawa.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So are you outsourcing all the workers or are you planning to hire local workers too?
So our intent is that all of the operational staff during the life of the facility, that 200 to 400 full-time workers, whether that be millwrights, operators, electricians, people doing payroll, accounts payable, safety advisors, our expectation is that we will try to hire locally, and where we cannot hire locally, we would expect those people to be moving to this community and becoming sort of a full-time member of the community. The reality is, however, during construction, sourcing 5,000 workers is going to be impossible from a region like this. And so while we would try to hire locally as much as we could, the reality is we would be bringing workers in from elsewhere in BC, Western Canada. Our intent would be BC first, neighboring provinces second, the remainder of Canada third, and where we were unable to meet our demands there, we'd be forced to go international.
Councillor Cunningham?
What training programs do you have in place right now for the people that aren't qualified for these jobs that will obviously be needed in 3 years in the local area and the provincial area to ensure that we're hiring more local if necessary?
So the types of jobs that we require in 3 years, which are the first site development construction jobs, really are skill sets that already exist. That's heavy equipment operators, that's forestry work, that's the large civil works. as we move past that into sort of the actual construction, concrete works, that are some skills that already exist in British Columbia and the region in Canada. We have not assessed demand at this time versus the available workforce. Part of that difficulty, of course, is understanding what other projects are going to go, but we would look to work with the various trade associations, colleges, and unions to get the right sort of construction staff in place. With respect to the full-time operating jobs, which are, you know, possibly a decade out, we'd be looking to hire and put people through various apprenticeship programs, which could include working them through simulations, it could include specialized college programs, or it could include seconding them to our facilities elsewhere in the world so they get hands-on experience before coming back here to operate the facility.
So you would definitely have priority to train Canadians or BC first and replace any foreign workers you have with them down the line, in other words?
That's absolutely the intent. So, and again, where we needed to bring in a specialist foreign worker, the intent would be that they would actually naturalize if they were here for operations. Construction, again, for a short 2 to 3 year commitment is a different case, of course.
Other questions? Councillor Thorkelson?
I have some questions. You might give me the same answer as you did regarding the watershed, but I was wondering about airshed studies, and if you have done airshed studies and how our air is going to be impacted, and then I have some questions about the airport.
So we have done airshed studies and modeling based on sort of what we call the base case, which is combined cycle generation. I could not give you specific details about the outcomes of that, and I would have to again refer you to one of the experts. But we'd be happy to put you in touch with our air quality specialist to answer any of your questions in detail.
And in addition to that, as Andrew mentioned earlier, the open house that we're hosting, or the EAO is hosting, that Aurora LNG will be participating in is this Wednesday from 4 till 8 at the Moose Hall, and we'll have experts on hand who were participating in those studies that might be able to answer your questions better.
And I was wondering what kind of safety precautions is the LNG project going to take, specifically with regards to flights landing and taking off from our regional airport, since you're right next door to it?
Yeah, so that's an excellent question. During the site selection process, we spent time doing a number of models and simulations to understand the interaction of an active airport and an LNG facility to ensure that the LNG facility would not have an impact on aviation safety. So we did some studies called plume rise assessments and flare radiance assessments to understand what would happen to aircraft that flew directly over the facility or that were on approach or takeoff at the time that the flare went off. We worked in conjunction with with some Australian consultants because they've got some very good regulations and experience around this area to understand that, and then worked with Navigation Canada and Transport Canada to share the results of the models, ensure that they felt the models were accurate, that they understood them, that the assumptions we were using to go into those made sense. And so all of those were also shared with the airport manager at the time that we did that. All of those models and all of the outcomes indicated that you could operate an LNG facility safely in that proximity to the airport. The other thing that we really worked to understand was sort of height restrictions around the airport based on the Nav Canada regulations, the safety regulations, as well as what they call the electronic zoning restrictions to ensure that there's no sort of radio chatter or blackouts with the aircraft and the instrument takeoff, landing, and various other sort of safety and navigation systems. And again, all of the work that we have done has made it quite clear that the two different operations can safely coexist with each other.
Is there any place you can refer us to in the world where you have built so close to an airport, or where a facility has built so close to an airport?
this would probably be the closest LNG facility to an airport. There are certainly other industrial facilities in close proximity to airports, but not an LNG facility, no.
And how close will you be to our airport?
It depends where you measure from. If it's sort of property boundary to property boundary, it's a couple hundred meters. If it's the center of the runway to the industrial core, it's approximately 2 to 3 kilometers, which is sort of the outer obstacle or outer surface limits in the Navigation Canada land use regulations.
Are they something like 4 kilometers?
I want to say that it's 3. I would have to get you a map, and we will have, I believe, some maps of that type available at the open house, and if we don't, we can get them to you.
Councilor Nish?
I think most of the questions have been answered, what I was thinking, but one statement I do have is that I do wish that, you know, moving forward, that that, you know, you take the city of Prince Rupert and basically really include us in the process, because I just feel that you know, being outside of our boundaries, some people may look at it where you don't have to participate with us, but this would be the community that would support that facility and provide housing, schooling, everything for that facility, and I do feel that it would have the greatest impact for, obviously, for infrastructure and everything. So I would like to, you know, just say that I would really like if you work well with the community, with the city, and with the residents of this town, even though it may be, I don't know if that's in Port Ed's jurisdiction or if it's in neither one of them, but just work with the community to and not just shove us aside saying, because we're not in your, you know, in our jurisdiction. So that's basically all I've got to say.
Thank you. Mayor Brain has done an excellent job of saying the same thing over the last few months, the several times that we've met with him. So that is a consistent message that we've been hearing.
Other questions?
As long as you're listening.
I'll just add one thing, too. I had the incredible opportunity about 3 weeks ago to visit Gladstone, Australia. I was there for 4 days. I was originally going on a holiday, but through some channels, I was able to get 3 days of meetings and then 1 day of visiting and touring the APLNG, which is the Conoco facility. One of the meetings that I had was with the Gladstone Mayor and Council and their planning team, and what I thought was going to be a half-hour coffee meeting with the mayor ended up being a 2.5-hour meeting of them grilling me with questions about our project and wanting to get into discussions with the mayor and council here in Prince Rupert on the good, the bad, and the ugly of LNG. I know that Mayor Brain has had some email conversations, I think, with Mayor Burnett in Gladstone, and he was very open to having a video or teleconference with the mayor and council and putting the planning team of Gladstone in touch with the planning team here in Prince Rupert. I think that's an excellent opportunity that I hope that you would take up, and I'd be glad to facilitate that. I guess the question that I asked the mayor and council, what I could take back to this mayor and council of their lessons learned, if there was one thing that they could tell the mayor and council here, is that don't allow 3 LNG facilities to be built at one time. That was their biggest issue. 3 projects were sanctioned within a 4-month time period and led to many different problems. They feel that had the facilities been built and staggered within 2 or 3 years of each other, that many of those issues would have gone away, that there would have been better collaboration and communication. But overall, I think that as I mentioned, they had, you know, some trying times with it, but feel that overall, now that they're operational, that there is a benefit to the community. So I do have some things here too that for you folks to have a look at, some pamphlets and so forth that I brought back from Gladstone, as well as a LNG industry housing program, a study that they did on housing in Gladstone, as well as a pamphlet on the Gladstone Region LNG Community Consultative Committee that they put together with all the proponents, and had, I believe it was 12 members on that committee that met once a month to, I guess, go through any issues that were created as a result of the LNG. And is still meeting today. I think it was established about 4 years ago, and is something that I think that could be looked at doing here as well. So thank you.
Thanks.
When was that committee formed? Before the project, or?
So the committee was formed, the projects were sanctioned in 2010, and the committee was formed in late 2011, I believe it was. I would suggest that if that was something that this area wanted to do, that not waiting until the projects are in the process of being built, that it's to be a little more proactive than reactive. But it's one of the many things of the 14 or so pages of notes and lessons learned that I took from that, is to you know, to do something like that earlier than later.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. I have two questions, and then I'm have those are all my only questions. We've initiated a project called our Planning for Major Projects initiative, where we've collected a variety of data in the community. Essentially, have done our own census. We've got lots of housing data. We're able to project, you know, if there's a $100 rent increase, how many people in the community would be displaced, those types of things. But one thing that's kind of overlooked that we have seen with projects of this size is where you guys are mandated to mitigate the camp workers, 5,000 man camp, is that there's also what's known as a shadow population that emerges around these industries, where people move to the community for other opportunities around the industry. And in our modeling, where we have modeled Fort McMurray and Kitimat and other areas that have experienced rapid growth, sometimes that can be a one-to-one ratio, where if you have a 5,000-man camp, that could actually potentially be 5,000 other people coming to the community looking for opportunity, particularly in an economic climate like we have here in Canada, where people in Alberta and BC are looking for work. And so if there's only one project, major project in Canada that goes through, we could potentially see a mass amount of people coming to the community looking for opportunity. And so that being said, one of the challenges that we've had is having companies acknowledge that there is such a thing as a shadow population, and that part of the responsibility of the company is to help us mitigate that bringing in of the population. And I think we would like to work with you guys on some data analysis and be able to share that Planning for Major Projects data with you guys to see if we can work together to plan some of those other things that I know that are still well a ways away, but we'd like to have those conversations early with you guys, because we think it's important, and it really is going to affect our housing situation in the community. And right now it's already a very tight situation, and we haven't had anything happen, and there's lots of speculative growth at this moment. However, when this does go through, we're probably looking at an increase in a boom, as you would say. And we feel that it's also responsibility of the company to help us mitigate that population that was also unplanned for, and it's not part of the core population of Prince Rupert. So just want to put that out there as something we'd like to work with you on. And the last thing is just wanted to maybe get an update where you guys are with Dodge Cove, one of our neighboring communities. Not sure if you've made any progress with them. Love to hear a status update on in terms of your relationship with them. And they are our neighbors, and of course, we like to look out for every Tibetan here in the region.
Yeah, so with respect to your socioeconomic reports, if we have not had an opportunity to get those yet, we would love to get those, understand them, and have a conversation with you. I have not been fully briefed by my team that was in the working group today, but I did understand that there was something raised by a City of Prince Rupert representative around us perhaps not estimating rent increases properly. So maybe that information is flowing in. With respect to Dodge Cove, we've continued to attempt to engage with them. not the easiest relationship by any stretch of the imagination. We do know that they are getting together with the Environmental Assessment Office
Thursday
to have a bit of a workshop with the Environmental Assessment Office. We had offered to be there, but Dodge-Cofe has requested that we not attend that session. So we'll continue to make ourselves available to have conversations with them around understanding impacts and potential mitigations. And we will see what the Environmental Assessment Office comes back with as well. We would also expect that they will attend the open house and make their opinions known. They're fairly reliable attendees of those events. So.
Dodge-Cofe also participates in the working group, as well as Des Nobles, who is the North Coast Regional District A representative, is on the working group committee as well.
Well, that's great to hear. I think from what I've, my discussions with them, is that they're feeling that as they are a small community, it's an Area A in the regional district, that they don't have the same type of capacity funding to participate in the EA process. So where the government, I believe, has given some grant money to First Nations communities to participate, as it is a very technical and intensive process. My understanding is that you have these folks working out of their kitchen tables trying to understand and read technical documents. That's not really their expertise. Are you guys prepared to help the community with capacity to funding to help them interact with you guys in the EA, as they are a community that requires consultation? Or is that something you've discussed with them?
That's not something we've discussed with them. We know that the BC Environmental Assessment Office provides funding, as well as CESA, as you'd mentioned. We're not sure where they at with that process. I suppose if they did approach us with a request for funding, we would have a discussion with them about that.
Okay, thank you. Any further questions from council? Okay, thank you very much for your guys' time today. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, moving on to 6A, reports and recommendations. Report from the corporate administrator. I'll just hold on for just one moment here. Okay, so we have a report from the corporate administrator regarding grant application for structural assessment engineering drawings for the refurbishment of the CNR station heritage building.
I'm Rory stand-in today.
Very good.
Less good-looking version, I think he'd say. all right, so my recommendation is, on behalf of Rory, that council approve by resolution the two-phase structural assessment and engineer drawings required to enable future refurbishment of the CNR building. So we're looking to apply for a grant in order to enable this, these structural assessment and engineer drawings. So there's the Canada 150 grant. The province is offering funding in order to celebrate BC communities and some of their heritage features. We are applying for it under Conserving Historic Places and Heritage Sites, so projects that preserve, rehabilitate, or restore formally registered, designated, or recognized historic places. And the CNR, the CN Rail building down at the waterfront, is the location that we're looking to apply for that for. It's a registered heritage rail site. So it's an iconic building. Like I said, it's a federal heritage site that reaches back into the city's history as the Grand Trunk Railway Terminus. The building, as we all know, is currently in disrepair and has sat vacant on the waterfront for many years. As we're looking to revitalize our waterfront, which has long been a priority for this community, this is one of the key pieces to that. Additionally, it was included in the redesign Rupert engagement, public engagement process, and that was something that the public identified as being a good project to undertake. So understanding really what this building needs is a two-phased approach to understand really the structural and then architectural needs. And the project will cost essentially staff time and then 20% or $20,000 of the overall projected costs, and then the costs are kind of broken down by what the phases of the structural assessment looks like.
Okay, questions from council? Councilor Thorkelson?
Our city's cost is $20,000?
If the assessment proceeds past the first phase, then it would be $20,000. If it just, it depends on what the outcome of the structural assessment of the building is. So whether or not you can proceed on to the more detailed engineered drawings, it depends on that first phase of the structural assessment, which could end up just costing, I think it's about $9,000 for the first, to the city for the first phase.
So it's $9,000 to $20,000?
Yeah, depending on.
If we're successful in the application. So it's low risk to apply first. Okay.
If the building's found to be restorable, is there other grants available because it's a heritage building and part of a railway system, et cetera, et cetera?
That's the hope. I know that having the engineered drawings in place will actually make us be able to apply for more grants, so having that in place actually helps us in terms of being able to eventually refurbish the building.
Other questions? Councilor Renhawk?
Do we have $20,000 available for if we need that for that?
Well, first we'd have to find out whether or not we actually got the grant, but the $20,000 component that's been included in this grant application resolution put before council would be included as a part of the overall budget, which is still to be considered this year.
Any further discussion? Okay, recommendation that council approve by resolution the two-phase structural assessment engineering drawings required to enable future refurbishment of the CN building. Moved by Councilor Cunningham, second by Councilor Niche. Any further discussion? All's in favor? Any opposed? Motion's carried. That's a great project. I think much needed in the community. Okay, correspondence for action. We also have two additional correspondence for action. Seems to be lots of support resolutions here today. So we'll start with the Prince Rupert Special Events Society. The recommendation is that the Prince Rupert City Council supports the application to Northern Development Initiative Trust from the Prince Rupert Special Events Society for a grant of up to $2,500 for Children's Festival from the Northwest Regional Development. Okay. Moved by Councilor Cunningham, second by Councilor Ranhawa. Discussion? Question. Okay, all those in favor? Any opposed? Motion's carried. 7B. Correspondence from the Prince Rupert and District Chamber of Commerce proclamation request. The recommendation is that Council proclaims the week of February 20th to 24th, 2017, to be known as Chamber of Commerce Week. Moved by Councilor Kinney, second by Councilor Cunningham. Discussion? Okay, all those in favor? Any opposed? February 20th to 24th is now deemed Chamber of Commerce Week. Okay, next one. Correspondence from the Prince Rupert Toastmasters Club regarding another proclamation request. Recommendation that Council proclaims February 2017 as being International Toastmasters Month in the City of Prince Rupert. Moved by Councilor Ranhawa. Oh, you're not moving it? Okay.
Question, comments? I'm a member of the club, and Prince Rupert Toastmasters is a non-profit organization for the purpose of helping local people to improve their organization communication skills, and we have members from 12-year-old to very senior people, and everybody welcome on Tuesdays 7:30 to 9 p.m. but I like to stay away from the boat.
Oh, right, okay, yeah, sure. Okay. Okay, we have to move first. Yeah. Moved by Councillor Morrow, second by Councillor Niche. Sure.
I just want to make sure that we're not in conflict by passing Chamber of Commerce Week within the month of, or Toastmasters Month.
I think we may be okay with that. Any other comments? I was also a member of Toastmasters in 2010, actually, when I first moved back to the community after university, and helped revive it at that time, and then it went back down, and now it's great to see that Toastmasters has actually become much more of a full-fledged organization with a lot of members, and it's something that's very beneficial to the community and helped me a lot with public speaking as well. So without any further discussion, all those in favor? Any opposed? Motion's carried. Okay, items. Light clap from the audience, like it. Okay, so correspondence from my Mountain Co-op, Shames Mountain. Late agenda item. However, these are grant applications are due both on the 10th. They're both. This one's to the community and the Ports Community Investment Fund, and it's to a letter of support for them to purchase a snowcat for the mountain, something that we regionally benefit. So they're asking for a letter of support from us for their application. Moved by Councilor Renhawa, seconded by Councilor Cunningham. Discussion? Okay, all those in favor? Any opposed? Motion's carried. And a similar one from the Prince Rupert Seaman Rugby Club. Are asking for a letter of support for equipment with them in the School District 52, looking to acquire a proper scrum machine. And there's a letter here from them, and it's also a application for the Ports Community Investment Fund, so they're looking for a letter of support from us for that. Moved by Councillor Randhawa, second by Councillor Kinney. Further discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed? Motion's carried. Okay, resolution from closed meeting.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On January 9th, 2017, at Council's closed meeting, the following resolution in regard to library appointments and Prince Rupert Business Advisory Committee appointments. Moved by the Mayor and seconded by Councillor Moreau, that Council review the applicants for the Prince Rupert Library Board and appoint Chelsea Keys and Glenn Guru, and that Council release the resolution at a future regular meeting of Council, and that was carried. Moved by the Mayor and seconded by Councillor Randhawa, that Council review the applicants for the Prince Rupert Business Advisory Committee and appoint Charmaine Carlson, Irene Mills, Mark Page, James Warburton, Brian Musgrave, Craig Uthet, and allow for one member of the Chamber of Commerce being either the President, VP, or Second VP only, and that Council release the resolution at a future regular meeting of Council, and that was carried.
Great. Thank you very much, and congratulations to those who have made the committee, and we're looking forward to getting those underway. Okay, and moving on to bylaw, we have a report from the Director of Operations regarding the 3rd Avenue West road closure bylaw. Mr. Long, do you want to just quickly update what happened here?
Sure. Yeah, this has just been a clerical error when it came to registration. One of the numbers was incorrect, so we're just having to pass it with the correct number.
This is something we've already done as a council, correct? Yeah, so we already did this. It just, unfortunately, there was an error in the... there, so the recommendations that council give first, second, and third readings with respect to the closure of a section of road on 3rd Avenue West. Moved by Councillor Renhawa, seconded by Councillor Moreau. Discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed? Motion's carried. And our final agenda item, report from the Manager of Community Development regarding the Interim Zoning Amendment Bylaw number 348, 2016, to temporarily establish commercial marijuana operations prohibited use in all zones. Do you want to make a final report?
So as council will recall, at the regular council meeting of January 9th, you received a report recommending the consideration of the proposed bylaw and gave first reading and second reading at that time and scheduled a public hearing for January 23rd. The regular meeting of council for the 23rd was subsequently canceled, and so the public hearing was as you just saw, just held. As a reminder, the original report to council described the purpose of the bylaw, which in short responded to the federal government's intention to legalize the recreational use of marijuana and to introduce regulations governing the manufacture, distribution, and sale of the product. Understanding that the provincial and federal regulations governing commercial marijuana operations are still as yet not known, that it's not possible for staff to develop fair and effective regulations for those future commercial operations without the knowledge of those regulations. And so recommending that the zoning bylaw be amended to create a temporary prohibition in all zones for commercial marijuana operations until January 1st, 2018. Public notification for this bylaw was posted in the local newspaper and publicly at City Hall. No public comments were received written over the front counter or directly to staff. And as you heard at the public hearing, some members came forward to have their voices heard on the issue. No cost is presented for this bylaw other than that of advertising and staff time. And council may now proceed to final consideration of the interim zoning amendment bylaw. I would like to take a moment to respond to one of the people who made their opinion known at the public hearing. In the original report to council delivered on January 9th, one of the directions or one of the recommendations in accepting the report was to direct staff to review the regulation once the federal and provincial regulations are known, and that, as I understood, is the direction of staff at this time.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so the recommendation is that following the public hearing, that council at the regular meeting considers giving third and reading and adopts the interim zoning amendment bylaw number 3408-2016. Moved by Councillor Kinney, seconded by Councillor Nish. Discussion? Councillor Thorkelson?
I was just wondering for clarity and maybe... And maybe it is already clear to everybody else, but it didn't seem to be clear to the people who came to speak, and that is that although you were very clear, Mr. Mayor, in your introduction, but the bylaw is not clear to say that it does not include medical marijuana. So I was wondering if it would be wise to... move an amendment saying commercial shall be amended to include new clause, the commercial production, distribution, or sale of marijuana products is prohibited in all zones except for medical marijuana clinics. I don't know if we want to add that in there. It was certainly specifically...
Just to ask a question to Mr. Seidemann, is the dispensary debate is that they're opening dispensaries as a medical dispensary. Does that fall into the recreational issue around dispensaries? Is there such thing as a medical dispensary that's legal? I guess what I'm getting at, because I do know you have to have a license to grow and sell at certain areas, but would that apply in this case if we were to move a motion forward? Does it hinder the ability for what the intention of this bylaw is?
Excuse me, Your Worship, but these are not things... The public hearing is closed. You can't really debate issues that haven't been raised during the public hearing. It really has to... Or we have to start over. Well, so you're looking for technical information that was raised at the public hearing? Is that what you're saying?
No, I'm just asking whether or not there's... If medical marijuana dispensaries is a different term than regular dispensaries, if there is two different situations there, that's
okay. The point is that we can't raise new issues after the public hearing before the bylaw is given its next reading. That's the issue.
Councilor Cummings?
In the public hearing, medical marijuana dispensary was brought up. If I go to a doctor tomorrow and he gives me a prescription for medical marijuana, where do I get it from?
At this juncture, I believe it's a mailed-in situation or that type of thing, right? From some sort of licensed operation. We're just seeking clarity on whether or not there is such a thing as a medical marijuana thing that could be a legal operation. Is there such a thing? I'm just... not sure if there's a differentiation, that's all.
I just want to be clear because in the prelude to the public hearing, I heard you to say, Your Worship, that a medical marijuana clinic would be okay.
Sorry. So the clinic that I said that was coming, they're not distributing marijuana. So they're helping people get like medical licenses and things like that, but they're not selling marijuana over the counter. It's strictly a clinic situation where they have a doctor present. There's no sale of marijuana. From what I understand right now, the only legal way to get marijuana is to have a license for it, and then usually they get that mailed in by a company that has a license with the Health Canada, and that's the way it goes. It's the dispensing of and selling of in a commercial way, even if it's for medical use, as I believe is what the issue is. And so I don't think that falls into this. I'm just seeking clarification if there is such a thing as a medical dispensary that would be somehow not included in this, but I think that's not the case. That's all I'm looking for clarification on here.
Well, I was just confused as to then, I guess I'm not up on it, on dispensaries, but I thought that a medical clinic was going to be dispensing, but if you just meant a medical clinic for...
Yes.
For... writing of prescriptions that you can fill through the post office, then
yes.
I understand that now. I thought that you were inferring that there's a difference. If there's no difference, then I understand, and okay. Then withdraw my suggestion.
Sure.
For an amendment.
Okay. It was just seeking clarification, but I think we've answered our own question there. So, okay, so the motion's on the floor. Okay, question? All those in favor? Any opposed? Okay, motion's carried. Noted, thank you. Okay, reports and questions from, thank you, Mr. Simon. Reports and questions from members of council. Mr. Randhauer.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to know, when we sold our mobile company to TELUS, what kind of arrangements we had with them? Like lately, we have lots of complaints for their service. Many areas, people can't receive or call phone calls, and they making complaints and nothing is happening. So I was wondering, if we can write down a letter to TELUS company to improve their service.
Sure. Actually, I can answer that because it was something I just recently checked in with staff about, because I also have been receiving a poor signal. You're talking about the mobile signals on east and west coast of town. So we're sending a letter out to TELUS. There are some issues around that, but there are some solutions that may be available, especially potentially installing boosters on the telephone poles, those types of things. So at this moment, we are engaging with them around that. And we're going to see if we can figure out a solution with TELUS around how we can boost the signals, because particularly on the east coast of town, some places don't have signal and yet people are paying for service. And I was talking to our first responder just today, actually, who's on call for the ambulance, and where they live, they have no signal in their home, so yeah. They aren't able to even get a phone call to do first responding. And so this could be a safety issue as well. So we'll definitely be pursuing that with TELUS, and that's something that I started working on last week. So the fact that you brought it up now is kind of works right into line with where things are going with that. And yeah, Councillor Cunningham?
Two things. The first one will be short and sweet. Is I went on Saturday night to the Performing Arts Theater Gala, 30-year anniversary, and it was phenomenal. It showcased a lot of local talent in that. I would just like to pay respect and dues to Crystal and the volunteer staff that put that all together, and over the last 30 years have done a lot of the work there. They're sort of unsung heroes in this town. It's not just Crystal, there's people before her and that, but it's quite the show to see, as some of us were, Councillor Nishu and that, and Randhauer were there. It was quite impressive. And you just don't know the work that goes into that until you talk to the people. Now, the second thing is, we all received a nice glossy little pamphlet in the mail about the replacement hospital for Mills Memorial. and they, I have no problem replacing Mills Memorial Hospital. It needs to be replaced. To the extent they want to replace it, I have a concern with it, because I am afraid if they go to the extent they are, that we will be losing services in our hospital as well as other local hospitals in the area. And for that, I would like both our MLA and any candidates that are running in this election to make it well known in Victoria that Prince Rupert Regional Hospital is a very large and important asset to the North Coast, the Haida Gwaii. With our port expansion being front and center, and with AltaGas and Aurora, we will be the region with the most growth in the near future. And I do not see, with our airport, why we need a trauma center that big, that close to us, when we can medevac anyone that bad south within an hour and a half to 2 hours. And it's not 14 hours to the next trauma center. So I just want people made aware that we have to be very careful with this situation, because if they put this trauma center in Terrace like they're hoping, we will be losing some of our services. And trust me, they're saying we're just going to consolidate. Well, they're going to consolidate a lot of our services in Terrace. And I think we're going to need them in this town, in this area for the North Coast, Haida Gwaii, as much as any other region. I think this will be the center of the hub for commercial area in the near future here, and not inland. And that's just my feeling on it.
Thank you, Councillor Cunningham. Any further reports? Councillor Thorkelson?
Yeah, I have one that falls out of the other. The mayor and I both were at a reconciliation a conference held in Prince Rupert by a I think they call themselves Reconciliation Canada, and it was an all-day affair, and it was made up of community leaders from First Nations and non-First Nations leaders of organizations and governments in our community. And at the end, there were some recommendations that are going to get written up, and when we get them, we should distribute them. And they're on the lines of how there's 95 recommendations done by the Reconciliation Commission, the Reconciliation Commissioner's report, and it was how are we to bring those recommendations into our community. So there's a number that have been written up, and two of them had to do with more than two, but two that I heard had to do with what we could do at City Council. And one was to promote First Nations First Nations individuals, get them involved in the city by promoting them to committees and commissions, city committees and commissions, to make sure that there's an affirmative action program to do that. And the second is just my pet peeve, which wasn't brought up there, so I guess I didn't tell. I told an alternative truth there. The second one is that I think we need to again reflect the faces of our community, and this is the third time I've raised it, albeit the first time in a public meeting, is that our recreation magazine that came out still is better now. It's better this time than it was the first time I raised it, but it still does not reflect what our community looks like, and I don't see why we aren't getting pictures. There are some pictures that this time it is better. There are some pictures of local people in local activities in that magazine, but that magazine needs to reflect the diversity of faces, particularly of youth, that use our recreation centers. So I don't want to go and see a bunch of blonde-haired, blue-eyed kids in the swimming pool when that is not. It might be the reflection of Pitt Meadows, but it's not the reflection. Well, I say that because my niece was on a soccer team there, and there's one. Everybody was blonde. I couldn't believe it. I felt Everybody was blonde. There's only one dark-haired kid in the whole soccer field, and that might be the experience in Pitt Meadows, but it's not the experience in Prince Rupert. And we should be showing and showcasing in our own magazines the diversity of our community. And so I brought that up as part of the reconciliation, because it very well could be one of the recommendations I didn't hear.
Okay, thank you. Okay, and entertain a motion to adjourn. Moved by Councillor Cunningham, seconded by Councillor Nish. All those in favor? Thank you. Meeting is adjourned.